Welcome to Afternoon Plus, Andrew.
Thank you very much.
Do you know, it strikes me that you wrote Jesus Christ Superstar when you were only, what, 21, 20?
Must have been 20 when I did it, yes.
And before that it was Joseph?
Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat was just before that, yes.
And then Evita?
Evita, yes. There was quite a gap between Superstar and Evita, during which I did a musical that didn't work called Jeeves. Then Evita was 1975.
But the point is that you took these great historic figures and grappled with reality.
Well, Tim Rice did, yes. Of course, yes, we both did. Indeed.
But your latest venture is the absolute reverse.
Yes.
Tell Me on a Sunday is about one Miss Nobody, in a sense, isn't it?
It's about one girl, who an English girl in New York, and indeed it's an ambition of mine I hope fulfilled. I've always wanted to do a show about somebody that size, as opposed to one of these vast historical personalities we've been talking about. I think Tim is happiest when he's dealing with big subjects, this particular piece is written by a lyricist called Don Black, I suppose, you know, that's different lyric writers respond to different subjects in different ways.
The whole process of collaboration, of course, must be almost impossible to describe.
Well, it is difficult to describe, but musicals are a very collaborative thing. You have to be able to collaborate to work on a musical because there are so many different elements involved. I mean, you have your director who has to be in charge, of course, but there's choreography and lighting and costumes, and there are so many different departments that just have to be able to collaborate.
Now, we've mentioned Tell Me on a Sunday. The album's coming out Friday,
very
just 2 days
yes,
from now, isn't it?
It is indeed, yes.
And there is going to be a BBC version of it in the near future.
Yes, they filmed a concert performance of Marty Webb singing it.
Of course, it's a one-woman show, isn't it?
It is indeed. It's perhaps from that slightly confusing montage of things out of order. What it really is it's the story of an English girl in New York. I know quite a lot of English girls in New York, and I guess perhaps quite a few of them are in this piece. But it's one girl, and it's a series, I suppose, of slightly unhappy love affairs and relationships that she just discusses with the audience. And as you say, it's about a character who's this size rather than a vast, great historical personality. I'm really quite excited because it is the first time I've done anything like that.
Did you write it with Marty in mind, Marty?
Well, Marty Webb is our new Evita. She's been playing Evita for a few performances when Elaine has been on holiday and things like that. She's terrific, and I saw her last summer in the show, and I just thought, magnificent, I must have her in this piece. But the piece was already pretty well progressed. I actually wrote it in New York, and I suppose it's got a sort of New York flavour about it.
Now, how would you describe it? It is, I think you've called it a song cycle.
Well, no, I don't think I've called it a song cycle.
Well,
I don't like
has.
That. People will do that. It really just is a one-woman show, and it's about love. I think it discusses things that perhaps are not normally talked about in quite this way in song. And I hope it's also theatrically effective. We did a performance on Monday, which I was really quite pleased with because it looked to me as if there was a sort of definite theatre possibility as I watched up from up front.
But as you said on before that performance, because I was there luckily, it's only 45 minutes, which is not quite right for a theatre performance.
Oh no, we need a second half, and the obvious second half is An American Man in London. And somehow the two should meet at the end. I don't quite know how to do that. It means I'm going to have to put my thinking cap on. But definitely from the reaction that we've had on Monday, which I honestly think is the best reaction I've ever had to any of my projects at this stage. I mean, it was really quite extraordinary. And I think we'll have to do some kind of second half for it and do it in the theatre.
You've only had one flop, haven't you? You've got two...
One's enough, you know.
Jeeves was a flop.
Indeed, a disaster.
Now, you've got Jesus Christ has been running for 10 years in the West End.
No, look, not quite that long.
Nine years,
We opened in August 72. August 72, so it's 8 years just about.
And Evita for 18 months. What do you remember most, the flops or the successes? The one flop.
Well, you see, I learnt so much about musical theatre when I was working on Jeeves. I learnt about all the things that don't work, and they're the things you have to learn about. I mean, I think it was Oscar Hammerstein who was, you know, always insistent that you had to have a few failures to know how to make things work. And that's true. It really is true.
Why?
Well, because, you see, in a musical, there are an awful lot of areas that you have to cover, as we said earlier. And the most important single thing, I think, for musical theatre is structure. I think if you've got the structure of the piece right, then, you know, things will work. And in Jeeves, we didn't have the structure right. It was just a muddle and a mess.
Surely what matters is the melodies. People like to go out.
But I think that you could have a phenomenal tune or a great song in a terrible show and it wouldn't work. I mean, there is a show running on Broadway at the moment, or has been, or off-Broadway rather, called Great Songs from Flop Shows, and they're all songs that nobody knows. Because you could have Some Enchanted Evening, which is perhaps one of the greatest love songs ever written. I think if you put it in Jeeves, I think nobody would have heard of it.
You keep on mentioning Rodgers. Is he somebody who's influenced you a great deal?
Richard Rodgers, I think, is one of the great melody writers of the 20th century. I mean, a superb original melodist. There's nothing you can say other than that. He just kept writing tunes that are entirely his own and entirely original.
Where do melodies come from? That sounds like a very foolish question, but they don't come out of the piano to you. They come from you to the piano, don't they?
Yes, I think you can sit down and you can write at the piano, or one can do, but I find that the tunes that I'm most pleased with, I tend to just sort of think of them in the bath or whatever. But I think the thing that you have to have is you have to have a year. What Richard Rodgers had, which was so remarkable, is that he had a year for what was going to catch people's attention. I mean, there's a great example of that was The Lonely Goat Herd, which, with great respect to his lyricist on that occasion, is not perhaps with its yodeling the greatest lyric that ever was written. But, you know, it's just the catchiness, the sheer, just the way he uses those yodeling intervals. He just picks from that, you know, something which is so entirely, you know, I mean it's I suppose not entirely original, but it's just a marvellous sort of knack he had.
It seems to me that you talk about knacks, that you find your inspiration from every kind of music. For instance, were you surprised when Variations with your brother became a hit? That is really basically classical music, a rock rhythm, isn't it?
But I mean, what I was really trying to do there was to write a concert piece to show Julian off. I mean, Julian is, my brother is a cellist, and I felt that it would be good to put him in the context with a rock band. And that's what the piece is really about. I think it's a sort of virtuoso performance piece.
But you are not consciously trying to bridge any imaginary line between classical music and popular taste.
No. I think that, honestly, there aren't lines or divisions in music, but I think just two kinds of music, good and bad.
When do you have most fun? When you're actually composing, when something is in preparation within the theatre, rehearsing, or when you're sitting in the audience and it's being performed? I'm presuming you do have fun.
The greatest moment of all is when you're in the audience and it's working. I mean, there's something fantastic about a show that's motoring and working. I mean, that's why I admire Hal Prince so much, who directed Evita, of course, because he's a superb craftsman. I mean, he's a structural man of the theatre. I mean, I keep mentioning this word structure,
but
it really is the most important thing in musicals, and I mean, Mr. Prince certainly believes in that. I learned a tremendous amount from him on the Evita production. In fact, Tell Me on a Sunday was written whilst the rehearsals for Evita were going on, and he's a good sort of headmaster to bring one's prep into. But you can learn a lot. I think, you see, he learnt his whole craft as a director from George Abbott as a stage manager. George Abbott was one of the most famous sort of names in American musical theatre, I suppose. And, I mean, Hal actually learned it all as a stage manager. You know, and it's sort of like, you know, building a bridge. He's got it all from there.
And do you think you're learning from him? Is that your ambition?
I think one would be mad not to try and take every opportunity to work with somebody like that one could get. But, you know, I think he regards himself as almost like a kind of relay runner who's got the sort of baton at the moment.
Yes.
And he has a sort of team of people around, and younger people also, who I think he's very keen to see that these things he believes in are passed on to. And I'm sure that a tremendous amount of it does come from that time when he was actually the stage manager for, you know, a tremendous number of very successful shows.